going to talk about are a few cases which are diagnosed basically on morphology, and then how should we proceed those cases and arrive at a correct diagnosis. So starting with the case one, a 5-year-old child is admitted with fever of 2 weeks duration. Child is pale, has both liver and spleen palpable, and we find that the child has got pancytopenia with hemoglobin of 7, TLC of 2400 and platelet count of 65,000. And the child is not responding to antibiotics, and already fever is for about 2 weeks. Since the child was having pancytopenia, so the bone marrow aspirate was advised. Now the bone marrow was slightly hypocellular considering the age of the child, and what we found was it was a normoblastic reaction. Erythroid precursors were present. Myeloid precursors were seen, and the myeloposis up to neutrophils was present. Megakaryocytes were adequate, though not seen in this picture. And what we found was that the macrophages were increased in the bone marrow. Now, and some of the macrophages showed hemophagocytosis. Here you can see a macrophage and it is showing phagocytosis of platelets. This side, what we find again a macrophage, and it has phagocytosed so many of erythroid precursors as well as some myeloid precursors. So here we have a case where there is hemophagocytosis. On the bone marrow defined biopsy in this one, what we found was the similar picture, normoblastic reaction of the erythroid series, and megakaryocytes were seen, and then there were large...
So there is some voice lag, is there, sir? If you want, you can switch off your video and then talk. There is some voice disturbance.
There is voice disturbance?
Right. Yeah. Now it is okay.
Okay, fine. So there were these macrophages, and macrophages did show hemophagocytosis. Now, this is a slide from another case where we came across hemophagocytosis, but on the bone marrow trephine biopsy, the macrophages were not as clearly seen as in this one, but we thought there are some macrophages to confirm. What we carried out was CD68. Now, this is a CD68 stain, and it is showing marked increase in macrophages, and some of the macrophages are showing hemophagocytosis. So what is your diagnosis? I know I cannot communicate with the audience as of now. So this is a case where there is hemophagocytosis. The child has liver and spleen palpable. Cytopenias are present. Are we dealing with a case of HLH? HLH is hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, and this is a syndrome. And there is systemic proliferation of the cells of the mononuclear system. Now, it is basically of two types. One is familial, the other one is secondary. Secondary group is the very, very common group. And in our country, we come across majority of the cases are secondary. Familial cases, they run in families, seen in children, autosomal recessive. And this is seen mainly in some European countries like Sweden. However, few cases are seen in India, and yesterday Dr. Chatterjee had shown two cases where they could diagnose on the basis of NGS. Now, what are the causes? It may be associated with malignancies, especially the T-cell lymphomas. Infections could be viral, EBV, CMV, parvovirus, dengue, and even COVID-19 can give rise to this. Parasitic, malaria, and leishmaniasis. Multiple bacteria and including tuberculosis can give rise to hemophagocytic syndrome. Then this is also associated with autoimmune diseases. In cases of autoimmune diseases, it is labeled as macrophage activation syndrome. Now this is talking about the parasitic diseases. Here we find a case where there are Kalazar. You can see these LD bodies in the macrophage. And macrophage is also showing us hemophagocytosis. So as such, there is pancytopenia in Kalazar, which is worsened by the presence of hemophagocytosis in these cases. This is a case of malaria. You can see the arrows where these are the gametocytes of the P. falciparum. Again, macrophages are increased, and they are showing not only hemophagocytosis, but phagocytosis of the malarial parasite also, that is the gametocytes of falciparum. So malaria also gives rise to pancytopenia and HLH. Now, HLH is a hyperinflammatory disorder, and it is characterized by massive immune cell activation, and that leads to severe multi-organ injury. Now, the causes I have already told you, it could be also the primary defect in the T cell and NK cell activity. Now we know that there is a cytokine storm which can go on in cases of HLH, and that leads to elevation of not only gamma interferon, but also tumor necrosis factor alpha, interleukin 1, interleukin 2, interleukin 6, and interleukin 18. These are the main ones, but there are so many other cytokines which are liberated in huge amount, and that leads to the severe symptomatology which we come across in these cases. The guidelines how to diagnose HLH. See, hemophagocytosis is one component of HLH. The other components are that it could be a molecular diagnosis, like yesterday Dr. Chatterjee showed that in two cases on next generation sequencing, they could diagnose mutations like FHL15. Other diagnostic criteria which are needed, whether it is a molecular diagnosis or an acquired cases, it should be 5 of the 8. Now, these 8 are fever, splenomegaly, cytopenias, at least 2 of the 3 lineages, hypertriglyceridemia, hypofibrinogenemia, hemophagocytosis. So that means if there are some cases in which there is no hemophagocytosis in the bone marrow, spleen, or lymph node, even then those could be cases of HLH. As and when hemophagocytosis is demonstrable, as in this particular case, it strengthens the point that we are dealing with a case of HLH. There could be a low or absent NK cell activity. Ferritin goes high, and so is soluble CD25, which is more than 2400 units per ml. Now, these macrophages, which we come across in HLH, they also show positivity with 11B, CD21, CD25, CD30, CD35, and also S100. Now, what is the treatment? In primary HLS, that is, which is hereditary, seen in European countries mainly, there is a combination of immune suppression by giving cyclosporin A and etoposide. However, in secondary HLH, which we come across every day, we have to treat the underlying bacterial or viral disease along with, of course, the supportive care. Now, the various complications which can occur are DIC, hemorrhagic shock, and neurological complications. So what is the pathophysiology of HLH? A, there is activation of T cells and their proliferation. There are cytokines which are liberated, and these result in fever. Then there is proliferation of the macrophages, and there is defective apoptosis. So again, these TNF-alpha, interferon gamma are liberated, which lead to persistent inflammation and fever. Inhibition of lipoprotein lipase leads to hypertriglyceridemia. Serum ferritin goes up, and it may go as high as 10,000 nanograms. And because of this, because of the secretion of plasminogen activator, there is chronic DIC. So what we find is D-dimer is present. Now, this is the mechanism now which is being explained in cases of COVID-19 infection also, where we know that the virus comes and combines with the ACE2 receptors of the lung alveoli. This is the respiratory epithelium. So this virus combines with these epithelial cells. There is proliferation of the alveolar macrophages, and the dendritic cells proliferate. As a result, there is secretion of multiple cytokines, that is IL-6, IL-1 beta, IL-12, TNF-alpha. And what happens is it leads to elevated hyperinflammatory acute phase reactants. That is why in all these cases, we are getting ferritin, D-dimer, and CRP done. And these excessive secretion leads to a cytokine storm. Also, there is leak into the circulation, and there is a systemic multi-organ failure. Now, this cytokine storm leads to endothelial damage of the capillaries of the lung, as a result of which we find that there is a adult respiratory distress syndrome and hyaline membrane disease occurs, as a result of which the patient is not able to breathe. There is a limited air exchange, and the patients go into a respiratory failure. Now this is the mechanism. Now we are very well aware of this COVID-19, and in these cases, wherever the bone marrow aspirate has been done, in about 50% of the cases, the hemophagocytosis has been demonstrated. We go on to case 2. A 52-year-old male admitted with progressive pallor of 6 months. Spleen is palpable, 3 centimeters. Liver not palpable, no lymphadenopathy. Since there is a progressive pallor, spleen is 3 centimeters. Clinical diagnosis was could be lymphoma or it could be a case of tropical splenomegaly. Hemoglobin was low at 9, TLC 2000. Differential polymorphs are reduced to 44 and lymphocytes are 52. Platelets are diminished to 70,000. No atypical cell in the peripheral smear. Bone marrow aspirate was a dry tap, and therefore the bone marrow biopsy was advised. So here we have a case of pallor, splenomegaly, pancytopenia. And this is the since there was pancytopenia, so the bone marrow biopsy was done and bone marrow aspirate was a dry tap. What we find here is this is an imprint smear. In the imprint smear, we can see these large mononuclear cells, which are larger than lymphocytes. They have a moderate to abundant cytoplasm. In some of them, some hairy processes like structures are seen. And this is the, since it was suspected that there could be hairy cells, and therefore acid phosphatase was carried out. This orange color is positive in these cells, suggestive of TRAP positivity. So TRAP positivity, and these are large cells without nuclei, moderate to abundant cytoplasm. This is a bone marrow trephine biopsy, which showed that there was space between each nucleus. Lot of space was seen. There was no overlapping of the nuclei as we've come across in cases of lymphoma. And in between, there were some, these red cells were present throughout the bone marrow trephine biopsy. This was giving a typical fried egg appearance or a box-like appearance where the nuclei are lying away from each other. And then the reticulin stain, as you can see, was increased, separating one cell from the other, and that is why the nuclei were not superimposed. So we have a case of splenomegaly, pancytopenia, fried egg appearance, increased reticulin. So the diagnosis is clear that we were dealing with a case of very likely hairy cell leukemia. Now, it needs to be confirmed by immunophenotyping. Now, hairy cell leukemia is a mature B-cell neoplasm. So obviously CD19, CD20 are positive. But the characteristic feature on flow cytometry is that these cells are CD25, CD103, and CD123 positive, along with positivity for CD11C. And now we are using CD200 also. Now we know that CD200 is also positive in chronic lymphocytic leukemia, and also in hairy cell leukemia. If we do a immunohistochemistry on a bone marrow trephine biopsy, the two things which are essential for demonstration are annexin A1 positivity and DBA44 positivity. Both of them are diagnostic of hairy cell leukemia. The other stains one can carry out are anti-TRAP, which is positive. CD5 is negative, unlike CLL and mantle cell lymphoma. However, there is differential diagnosis, so that are we dealing with a case of hairy cell leukemia as such, or is it hairy cell leukemia variant, or could it be a SLVL or splenic marginal zone lymphoma? Then now we know that BRAF mutation, BRAF V600E, is diagnostic of hairy cell leukemia. So what we have to do is to confirm that it is hairy cell leukemia, because we want to give a specific therapy of cladribine, which is very, very effective in hairy cell leukemia. So we have to carry out A, immunophenotyping, and B, we have to carry out the mutation studies to demonstrate BRAF positivity. Now, this is the flow cytometry from this case. And what we find here is on this side is CD19, CD5. So these cells are CD19 positive, but CD5 is negative. Then we know that CD23 is negative, but CD19 is positive. Now 5 and 23 we carry out for CLL, and then this population shifts over here. So 5, 23 are negative, 19 is positive, so mature B cell marker. And then we have CD38, which is positive. CD45, of course, is positive, but CD10 is negative. And then we find that 79B is positive, which is usually DIM positive in cases of CLL. CD200, now like CLL, this is also positive in this case. And FMC7 is positive. Now FMC7 is usually negative in cases of chronic lymphocytic leukemia. So we have clonality, which is positive. We can see that all the cells are kappa positive. Then we come across these specific markers, which are CD25 and CD103. Both the markers are positive. CD103 is positive, CD25 is positive, 103 is rather bright, and this is moderate. And of course, the HLA-DR and 11C are positive. So the presence of CD25, 103, these are the specific markers, along with CD200 and FMC7, and of course the CD19 positivity confirms that we are dealing with a case of hairy cell leukemia. Now this is again to show you that the number of hairy cells in the peripheral smear or in the bone marrow is usually very less. Now this is CD20 gating we have done. On this side is a side scatter. These are the myeloid cells which are seen. This is the debris. And out of the lymphocytes, the positive one, CD20, is this population. And this population turned out to be CD11C positive, HLA-DR positive, 25 and 103, which are characteristic for diagnosis of hairy cell leukemia. Now, in all cases, we are not able to get a good bone marrow aspirate. Therefore, the immunophenotyping by flow is not possible. The peripheral blood does not show good number of hairy cells. Again, it is not possible. So then we are left to the bone marrow trephine biopsy. On bone marrow trephine biopsy, we find that these cells are CD20 positive, confirming their B cell nature. DBA44 is positive. So is annexin A1. So annexin A1, DBA44, CD20, they confirm that this is a case of hairy cell leukemia. Here you find the membrane positivity in cases of annexin A1 along with the dull nuclear positivity. Cyclin D1 positivity in hairy cell leukemia is seen in about 50 to 60% of the cases, but the annexin A1 positivity confirms that it is hairy cell leukemia. Now, hairy cell leukemia is classical one. We may come across some hairy cells in the peripheral blood. Here you find two peripheral smears. These cells are larger than lymphocytes. They have got a delicate cytoplasmic borders, and you can see these cytoplasmic projections, hairy projections, which are seen in these cases. In the spleen, since the spleen is enlarged, the involvement is seen mainly in the red pulp. And not only in the red pulp, we also find that there are red blood cell lakes are positive in the spleen section. Of course, the liver and lymph node involvement is uncommon. Usually, it is not seen in these cases. But the differential diagnosis has to be made, number one, since there are no hairy cells if in the peripheral blood, we have to distinguish it from various causes of pancytopenia, which could be aplastic anemia, hypoplastic MDS, hypoplastic acute leukemia, PNH, and myelofibrosis. Morphological resemblance is to hairy cell leukemia variant, splenic lymphoma with villous lymphocytes, BPLL, and large granular lymphocytic leukemia. Now, this is an example or a peripheral smear from a case of BPLL. In pro-lymphocytic leukemia, the TLC is high, as you can see. Cells are larger, and then you find that in these cells, moderate amount of cytoplasm is present. Chromatin is stippled, but what you find a typical thing in PLL is the presence of nucleoli. Each cell will show us an eccentric nucleolus, which is diagnostic of PLL. Then we come across a hairy cell variant. Now the WHO says that hairy cell variant is not related to hairy cell classical, but see the morphology, it does resemble again the hairy cells. Moderate to abundant amount of cytoplasm, and then you find the nuclei are similar to those seen in hairy cells, but here the nucleoli are again visible. So there could be a problem in differentiating PLL from hairy cell variant, but from hairy cells it becomes easy because in hairy cells there are no nucleoli, while in hairy cell variant we find that the nucleoli are prominent. And also in hairy cell variant, we find that the TLC could be higher. Then WBC count is higher and the bone marrow is easy to aspirate because there is no fibrosis of the marrow. Then how do you differentiate on flow? On flow, we find that the variant cells are CD25 negative. On immunohistochemistry, they are annexin A1 negative. On flow, they are also CD200 negative. So that is how we can differentiate between hairy cell variant and hairy cell leukemia. Then differences between classical and variant, we also come across that in classical hairy cell leukemia, there is monocytopenia, while in variant, there is no monocytopenia. And then of course, the CD25 and CD200. Now here, I told you that there are red cell lakes in the spleen, why such lakes are not seen in spleen in hairy cell variant. The other possibilities the differential diagnosis, a major one is splenic marginal zone lymphoma or SLVL. In splenic marginal zone lymphoma, again, we come across in the peripheral blood, there are cells which have got hairy projections, and these are seen in 10 to 30% of the lymphocytes. And this also has got an indolent course and may progress to large cell lymphoma. But here we find that there is a mainly involvement of the white pulp. And in the white pulp, we find multiple nodules. Now this is a splenectomy from a case and you find that whitish nodules are seen. These are the lymphoma nodules, which are seen not only on the cut surface, but also inside. It is mainly the involvement of the white pulp. And then you find this nodular pattern of the lymphoid cells, which are CD20 positive. And then we confirm splenic marginal zone lymphoma by CD20, 79A positivity. These cases may be DBA44 positive, but they are annexin A1 negative, BCL6 negative, cyclin D1 negative, and of course the CD103 and 25, these are negative. So that is how we can differentiate a case of hairy cell leukemia from PLL, from splenic marginal zone lymphoma, as well as from hairy cell variant. A new entity has come up, that is a splenic diffuse red pulp lymphoma. Now in splenic diffuse red pulp lymphoma, again, there is involvement of the red pulp, but what we find the typical cells in the peripheral blood show a bipolar processes. At the two poles of the cells, you will find there are hairy processes, and these are seen in 10 to 30% of the lymphocytes. This has got indolent course, but then these hairy cells need to be differentiated from the hairy cell processes of the classical hairy cell leukemia. But of course, with immunophenotyping, we can differentiate one from the other. So in this case, the final diagnosis was hairy cell leukemia. We go on to case number 3. This is a 58 years old female who came with pain at the fingertips. There was bluish discoloration of the fingertips. And what we find on the cell counter, WBC is high, 20,000. Red cell count is even less than 1 million, 0.5 only. Hemoglobin is very low, 4.9. Hematocrit is 7. Now, it is not tallying with the 4.9 grams of hemoglobin. It should have been around about 15, but it is only 7. MCV is 130, very, very high. MCH is around about 90, that is okay. But MCHC is going haywire, 67. Now, there is something wrong. Either the cell counter is not working properly or the sample is wrong. That is what the conclusion is drawn from this data, which we come across. There is abnormally high MCHC. There is macrocytosis with a very, very high MCV of 130, disproportionately low red cell count, spuriously high WBC smear. And then what we find on the peripheral smear, in the peripheral smear, we find there is anemia. The number of the red cells is less. whatever red cells are present, they are forming agglutinates. There is autoagglutination of the red cells, which is occurring. There is a slight coloring of the background plasma. And what is happening is that these are being counted as one cell. So these may be counted as white cells. That is why the TLC is high, though the patient has a low TLC. That is why the MCV is higher, because there are double red cells, triple red cells, and multiple agglutinates are there. Now, what do we do if we want to use a cell counter, still do the differential? Is number one, we should warm the sample to 37 degrees Celsius. And then if we add saline, warm saline, 37 degrees centigrade to the sample, then if we run the on a cell counter, then we will get, because at 37 degrees centigrade, we find that the cells separate from each other. That is, the antibodies with which the red cells are combining, they dissociate. So that means these are working only at a low temperature. And therefore, probably something to do with the cold type of autoimmune hemolytic anemia. So in this case, the diagnosis is cold agglutinin syndrome. Now, this is caused by autoantibodies that react at a temperature of less than 37 degrees Celsius. Now, what are the various causes? The causes are lymphoproliferative disorders, that is mainly the lymphomas, and then idiopathic, which is uncommon, and these are associated, may be associated with clonal B cell population. Infections like infectious mononucleosis and mycoplasma. Now, all these lead to lymphoproliferative disorders, idiopathic. There is secretion of IgM, and the red cells combine with the IgM, forming the red cell agglutinates and resulting in anemia. So the hemolysis is both extravascular as well as intravascular. So what we have to do is to confirm the diagnosis. Number one, we should check for the Coombs test. And number two, since the causes are there, known causes, lymphoproliferative infections, so we should investigate the patient for NHL, infectious mononucleosis, as well as for mycoplasma. Now, this patient, first thing was to rule out NHL. This patient had no peripheral lymphadenopathy. So therefore, a bone marrow biopsy was carried out. PET CT was not carried out, but the CT-guided core biopsy was not taken, because in the abdomen, there was an abdominal lymphadenopathy which was positive. So it was highly suggestive that it could be a case of NHL involving the abdominal lymph nodes. So since it is easier to do a bone marrow biopsy, so that was done. And what did it show? It showed us the nodular deposits of lymphoma, which was CD20 positive and various other markers were positive, with a high KIE 67. So this was a case of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma resulting in autoagglutination of the red cells, what we call as cold agglutination disease. Now, this occurs mainly in winters, but we have to distinguish these agglutinates of the red cells from the roulet formation. Now, here you can see in roulet formation, these are coins in stacks. You find these coins one upon the other. While in agglutinates, they're all around. You will find in the center, there is IgM globulin molecule around which all these red cells are gathered. And since it is a pentamer antibody. So the various causes in which hypergamma globulinemia can occur are multiple myeloma, Waldenstrom macroglobulinemia, Kala-Azar, cold agglutinin disease. Now, these are all causes of roulet formation, hypergamma globulinemia. So what we should do is Coombs test and to confirm that this is a case of cold agglutinin disease. Now, we carry out direct Coombs test and indirect Coombs test also. You are all aware of. Now, here the important thing is that the Coombs test is basically an anti-globulin test. So here you find that these are the anti-globulins which are there. And these anti-globulins combine with the red cells. And this is the antibody already on the surface. So that leads to agglutination. However, in cases of cold agglutinin disease, there is a complement C3D on the surface. Now, since there is a complement C3D on the surface, so what we need are antiglobulin, which is directed against C3. So that means we should have anti-C3D Coombs serum. If we do not have anti-C3D Coombs serum, we may miss the diagnosis because the Coombs test will come out to be negative. So therefore, whenever we are doing Coombs test, we should see to it that the manufacturer has added anti-IgG as well as anti-C3D. If both are present, then we will be able to pick up in this particular case anti-C3D antibodies and confirming that it is a cold agglutinin disease. Now, we know that there are three types of autoimmune hemolytic anemias. Depending upon at what temperature the antibodies combine with the globulins, that is warm autoimmune at 37, cold autoimmune less than 37, it consists of two diseases, cold agglutinin disease and paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria. And then we have mixed type autoimmune hemolytic anemia, where we have antibodies which act at 37 and which combine at less than 37, which are seen in SLE and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Now, this disease, it affects mainly the middle-aged and elderly, and it could be either primary or secondary in etiology. Secondary, I told you, is because of the lymphomas or infectious mononucleosis. Now, there could be intravascular hemolysis once the complement system is activated, as IgM combines, complement combines with the antigen antibody, and then the C9 is activated up to C9 leading to intravascular hemolysis. Sometimes this does not occur. What we find is that there is an Fc receptor and the antibody combines, so the opsonization occurs and there is RBC phagocytosis in liver and spleen, so extravascular hemolysis. So this is one disease where there is both intravascular as well as extravascular components. So what is the management is we should remove the cause, that is treat the lymphoma. Rituximab has been found to be very, very useful, and one should avoid cold weather in these disease. So the final diagnosis here was BNHL with cold agglutinin disease. We go on to case number 4. 64 years male, he was admitted for prostate surgery. TLC was 9,600. What we found was the lymphocytes were increased, 43%. Rest, everything was normal. You can see the smear, platelets are all right. Polymorphs, 3 lymphocytes are seen. 4 months later, he was, of course, subjected to prostate surgery, which was carried out successfully. 4 months later, again, we find that the polymorphs are 50. Lymphocytes are slightly increased from 43 to 45%. Patient had persistent lymphocytosis. That is one. Not seen in this, but occasional smear we found was a smudge cell. Now, we know that the smudge cells are seen in cases of CLL. So we advise, number one, bone marrow aspirate and also flow cytometry analysis of the peripheral blood. Now, on bone marrow aspirate, what did we find? Myeloid precursors, myeloposis is very well normal. You can see the erythroid precursors, normoblastic reaction. And then you find these dark staining lymphocytes. The lymphocytes were increase in the bone marrow. So we have a case of mild lymphocytosis, and here you have in the peripheral blood as well as in the bone marrow. Now this is a bone marrow defined biopsy. By and large, the whole biopsy was normal. A 2 centimeter long biopsy was normal. There were only 3 small foci of lymphoid infiltration. Mature lymphocytes were seen. Not enough to label as lymphoid nodule or lymphoid follicle, but there was an interstitial tiny infiltrate in the bone marrow defined biopsy. So interstitial infiltrate, rounded lymphoid aggregates was seen in this particular case. So what is the diagnosis? Now here we have a case of mature lymphocytosis, and there we find that it was a case suggestive of mono. This is a B cell lymphocytosis. This is seen whenever there is a monoclonal B cell lymphocytosis. Now, what happens is that if we do the flow cytometry as carried out in the peripheral blood, we find that this is the population in question, green population. CD5 is positive, so is CD20. So CD5 and 20 positive. And then these cells are kappa negative. Here we find CD23 is positive. Now this is a configuration of CLL. CLL, we find that CD25 and 23 are positive. So in this population also, these were positive and they were clonal. Only lambda was positive, kappa was negative. So it is highly suggestive of monoclonal B cell lymphocytosis, and this is CLL type. Now this is the full flow cytometric analysis, just to show you that this is a population, this small population on the right, which is CD19, CD5 positive, CD23 positive. Then you find that here CD45 positivity. Now these cells were also CD200 positive like CLL. So 19, 5, 23, CD200 positive. Then these are lambda positive. And then you find that 103, that is, and CD25, these were negative. So hairy cell markers and others were negative. CLL-like picture, but the number was less than 5,000. Now this is labeled as monoclonal B lymphocytosis. Now what is monoclonal B lymphocytosis? Number one, they have to be clonal B cell, like in this particular case they were. They have to be less than 5,000. If they're more than 5,000, then we label that case as a case of CLL. Now this is seen in otherwise healthy individuals. And there could be three types of monoclonal B lymphocytosis. CLL-like, as this one. Atypical CLL-like, where there could be a bright CD20, or there could be an expression of FMC7, or it could be a CD5 negative monoclonal B lymphocytosis. Now, it is believed that the CLL is preceded by monoclonal B cell lymphocytosis. First time it was described in blood in 2008. And what we find is the status of MBL is similar to MGUS. See, we know that the multiple myeloma cases are preceded by MGUS. Similarly, the CLL cases are preceded by MBL. In these cases, there is an increased risk of CLL at a rate of 1 to 2% per year. So now it has, WHO has further subclassified into two categories. One is a low count category where the count is less than 500. And the high count category between 500 and 5,000 clonal lymphocytes. If it is less than 500, it is not associated with CLL and the progression is very, very slow. If it is a high count, that is 2,000, 3,000 count, then it progresses on to CLL, and it is believed to be this is the precursor of CLL cases. In the CLL type picture, we find that the genomic analysis is similar to that of CLL. So this was the case of monoclonal B cell lymphocytosis, and flow cytometry of persistent lymphocytosis should be carried out to confirm the diagnosis of monoclonal B lymphocytosis. I go on to case number 5. This is a 7-year-old child admitted with fever, pallor, splenic tip. Count was 15,000. What we find here are the blast cells. And these blast cells are, this is MPO, positive in few of the blast cells. So the diagnosis was AML. Patient was given chemotherapy. Then what happened after ending the chemotherapy from day 4 to day 19? All of a sudden, up to day 10, the child was doing very well. Sudden fall in hemoglobin to 5, fall in TLC to 1500, platelets fell down to 12,000 from 45,000. And this patient now had pancytopenia. So the blood transfusion antibiotics were started. We thought that the patient has gone into a relapse. So we advised a bone marrow aspirate and bone marrow biopsy. What we find on the bone marrow aspirate are these cells which are necrosed. The morphology is not well made out. The nucleus is broken. The cytoplasmic borders are broken. And there were some red cells in between. But the on aspirate, we could not see the blast cells. So we thought this could be a necrotic material. Patient expired 2 days later. And this is the bone marrow trephine biopsy, which we had carried out, showing a massive necrosis of the bone marrow, not only of the bone marrow, but of the bony trabeculae also. You can see the osteocytes are not seen in these lacunae. So this was a case of bone marrow necrosis. Now, bone marrow necrosis, there is necrosis of both the hematopoietic and sometimes of the bony trabeculae also. Patient may present with bone pains and fever, elevated LDH. And since there is necrosis, so the counts fall and the patient comes to us with pancytopenia. Another picture of bone marrow necrosis, massive necrosis. Where do we find necrosis? All hematologic malignancies can lead to bone marrow necrosis. ALL, AML, CML, NHL, Hodgkin, multiple myeloma. And then the metastatic deposits, few cases of sickle cell disease, because the sickle cells, they block the capillaries, resulting in marrow necrosis. Typhoid fever and of course tuberculosis, Q fever, and also parvovirus and HIV infection, sometimes in histoplasmosis, and lastly in DIC. Now, bone marrow necrosis is indicative of primary or metastatic. Now, this is a case of massive necrosis, but at one edge, we could see some metastatic deposit cells, carried out the markers, and we found that CK7 was positive in these some degenerating cells and some viable cells, and few cells were seen even in necrotic cells, which demonstrated a positivity. This is a case of sarcoma, which had gone into the bone marrow, and this is the sarcoma, and what you find is a massive bone marrow necrosis. Now, it is not uncommon to find map-like areas of necrosis in the bone marrow trephine biopsy and separated by viable areas. And what we find are, these are the ghost cells, since mostly it is a coagulative necrosis. Pathogenesis of the bone marrow necrosis is that there could be a vessel compression resulting in hypoxia, or the cytokines like TNF liberated by the macrophages or by the leukemic cells, or it could be increased metabolic demands by the high amount of tumor tissue in the bone marrow and sometimes the DIC. So the final diagnosis in this particular case was bone marrow necrosis. But what is needed for diagnosis is that we should have a bone marrow trephine biopsy to demonstrate that there is bone marrow necrosis. Case number 6, a 5-year-old child with fever 2 weeks, spleen is 4 centimeters, liver 2 centimeters, low hemoglobin of 7 grams, mildly low TLC of 3400, platelets are 95,000. Child has pancytopenia, retic count is low, and fever, no response to antibiotics. Now what we find on the bone marrow aspirate are erythroid hyperplasia, that was very, very obvious. And then what we found was that these erythroblasts, some of them appeared binucleated, but majority of them had dumbbell-shaped nuclei. And these two nuclei were joined by a thin chromatin bar. The iron stores was increased. And that is how a typical congenital dyserythropoietic anemia, joined by a thin chromatin bar, dumbbell-shaped nuclei. If you do the electron microscopy, there is a Swiss cheese appearance of the nuclear membrane, which is characteristic in these cases. Now, CDA is a rare autosomal recessive condition. If the child has pallor, spleen is palpable, iron stores are increased, then, and the retic count is not high, one should think of the possibility of CDA. Especially if we find that there is dysmorphism of distal limb abnormalities, short stature, vertebral malformations, one can think of CDA type 1. Now, the mutations in CDA1 or codamine 1 gene is seen in CDA1. Then we have CDA1, 2, 3, these are the major ones, but now up to CDA7 are known. CDA2 is characterized by these binucleated erythroblasts and few multinucleated erythroblasts. And then we have CDA3, in which we find these gigantoblasts, 1, 2, 3, these gigantoblasts, multinucleated ones are seen. And this is autosomal dominant condition, while CDA1 and 2 are autosomal recessive condition. So the final diagnosis here was CDA type 1. I'll briefly go over the next case of CD7. Case number 7, 2-year-old child admitted with pallor, cervical lymph nodes, spleen of 6 centimeters. And what we find on the bone marrow aspirate was it was diluted. But what we could see were some histiocytic large cells. They were having a coffee bean appearance of the nuclei. This is the HE stain. This is the Jeemza stain and large amount of cytoplasm. Now, this is a typical appearance. So these were histiocytes and myeloid erythroid cells were diminished and suggestive of that we are dealing with the case of Langerhans cell histiocytosis. This is a bone marrow defined biopsy where the coffee bean appearance of these cells was very well made out. And since it was a child, possibility of acute disseminated LCH was considered, but it needs to be confirmed by CD1A, which is a specific stain, along with, of course, the CD68, or one can do CD207. Now, this is a disease which we always believe that it arises from the dendritic cells. And now we know that two mutations one should look for. First is BRAF mutation, which is also positive in hairy cell leukemia, and also in mutations of MAP2K1 pathway. Now, that is characteristic in these cases. What is important is that a recent article published a few months back in Blood says that it is a clonal expansion of myeloid precursors. So far, we always believe that it is the dendritic cells. These are dendritic cells, but these probably arise from the myeloid precursors, which differentiate into CD1A and CD207. Positivity. It is probably a misguided myeloid differentiation model of LCH ontogeny. Then, of course, there are three types you are all aware of: unifocal type, and the previous one was multifocal, in which you find the eosinophils are there along with these LCH cells, and then the unifocal type, what we call as eosinophilic granuloma, where there are lytic lesions in the bones and there is majority of eosinophils are present in this. So the final diagnosis was LCH. I'll skip this case for want of time.
No issues, sir. You can go ahead. We're going to have the post lunch at 2:31, so we can go.
I think no. This is a long one, so.
Okay.
I'll go to the next one. Last case. All right. This is a small case, case number 9. A 25-year-old male came to dental OPD. There is a swelling in the upper gum. Treatment was given. There was no relief. Systemic examination normal. TLC, DLC normal. Biopsy was taken. Now, this is a biopsy, what you all can see is stratified squamous epithelium from the gum. And what we find underneath are monomorphic cells. They have a vesicular nuclei, prominent nucleoli. They are of uniform size and shape. So the possibility thought was that we are dealing with a case of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, maybe Burkitt lymphoma, or it could be a small round cell tumor. That was based on the this biopsy. And what we did was carried out the various markers on this biopsy. And we found that CD13 was positive, which is a myeloid marker. CD117 was positive, which is again a myeloid marker. MPO was positive in these cells. So was CD68. All the lymphoid markers were negative. And then CD33 was positive. Also CD34 was positive. Megakaryocytic marker CD61 was negative. Erythroid marker CD71 was negative. Only CD43 was positive. Now, along with the myeloid markers and precursor markers like CD34 positivity and CD43, which is positive in cases of myeloid sarcoma or granulocytic sarcoma, a diagnosis of myeloid sarcoma was given. Now, a myeloid sarcoma, or earlier we used to call it pleuroma or granulocytic sarcoma, it is an extramedullary myeloid tumor. It is a solid tumor composed of immature white blood cells. If you do not have immunostains, one may think on the possibilities of a round cell tumor or a lymphoma. 2 to 8% of the AML cases may present like this. And the AML which is usually involved is M4 or M5. Now, this could be a precursor of AML. That is one possibility. Second is that there may be associated acute leukemia in these cases of myeloid sarcoma. In our case, TLC, DLC was normal. Bone marrow aspirate did show about 7 to 10% blast cells in the bone marrow. So we knew that this patient is probably going on to an acute leukemia case, which he did 2 months later. So AML, M4 or M5 or even M2 or M1 can present at times as myeloid sarcoma. Now the various sites where it can occur are lymph nodes, subperiosteal in the bone, skin, orbit, spinal canal, mediastinum, central nervous system, oral and nasal mucosa, in the breast, genitourinary tract, chest wall, and testes. Skin is a primary site in pediatric patients, and this could also develop in the ocular region. Now, it could be a primary manifestation, as I told you, of AML, or it could be an early indicator of relapse. If we have got a case, we have already treated, so it could be an indicator of relapse, or it could be a case of harbinger of blast crisis in CML. Suppose we have a patient of CML who is being treated, and all of a sudden you find a nodule developing in the oral cavity in a female, in a breast or under the skin. It could be a blast crisis, which instead of occurring in the bone marrow or manifesting the bone marrow, is manifesting in this soft tissue lesion. Grossly, these are firm, fleshy, and they resemble sarcoma. And then there are sheets of these myeloblasts, but then we need immunohistochemistry to confirm. WHO has classified into 4 variants. First is the blastic variant, where there are predominantly myeloblasts, as our case. It could be immature variant, where there are myeloblasts along with promyelo and myelocytes. Then there is a differentiated variant where you find maturation up to granulocytes is also present along with promyelo, myelo, and beta. And then there are monoblastic or monocytic variant are also seen. Occasional one, there are few case reports of erythroid as well as megakaryocytic variants of these myeloid sarcomas. So the final diagnosis is myeloid sarcoma. Idea was to awareness of this entity. Number one, that we should be aware that the round cell tumor or lymphoma-like picture could be seen in myeloid sarcoma. And its confirmation by immunohistochemistry is essential. So with this, I finish a few cases in this slide seminar. And I thank Dr. Padmavati and her team for inviting me to share. This is actually a book I've written for MD and DNB pathology students, practical exam, which has all the exercises of exam given. And multiple authors, Dr. Geeta Jayaram is a well-known cytologist. Dr. Neeta Khurana is histopathologist, MAPC. Thank you very much, Dr. Padma. Any questions?
Thank you very much, sir. It was really wonderful listening to you. And it was very, you started in a very basic way and took us all through all the molecular techniques and even the basic practical aspects, like how to differentiate between Roux-lay and agglutination. So all that you emphasized, John, it was really wonderful listening to you. There are one or two questions. How to differentiate between micromegakaryocyte and in CML and blast? That is one question.
In CML, there is a tremendous proliferation of myeloid precursors. And myeloproliferative disorder is different from MDS. Micromegakaryocyte, Dr. Chandra just showed 1 hour earlier, a beautiful micromegakaryocyte she showed, where the nucleus was round and there was moderate amount of cytoplasm. Now, micromegakaryocyte by and large are not seen, is not a feature of myeloproliferation. And of course, CML is a myeloproliferative disorder where we come across dwarf megakaryocytes. Now, dwarf megakaryocytes are 2 to 4 times the size of a micromegakaryocyte. There, the cytoplasm is mature. The nuclei are hypolobated and small. That is why we label them as dwarf megakaryocytes. And they are functioning. That is why you find thrombocytosis occurring in these cases of CML.
What is the prognosis in myeloid sarcoma?
Myeloid sarcoma should be treated as it is a case of AML, irrespective of whether the blood or the bone marrow are involved or not. And the prognosis is similar to the type of which it is made up of. Suppose we find it is made up of M2 type of picture, then the prognosis will be similar to that of M2. Suppose it is a M4 type of picture, then the prognosis will be similar to what we find in M4 cases of AML.
Cause of hypersegmentation of neutrophils in megaloblastic anemia.
In?
Megaloblastic anemia, sir. Cause of hypersegmentation of neutrophils.
See, what causes hypersegmentation is, see, we know that the early megaloblast is larger, so is intermediate, so is late. Similarly, we find that the myelocytes are larger. Metamyelocytes are obviously large. That is why we say, look at for the giant metamyelocytes. And these cells which are able to mature, they remain in the bone marrow for a longer time and they keep on enlarging, resulting in enlargement of the red cells as well as enlargement of the polymorphs. The hypersegmentation of the nuclei, which occurs not only in the neutrophils, but it also occurs in megakaryocytes, is because of the fact that the DNA maturation has been affected. And that DNA maturation becomes abnormal, leading to hypersegmentation of the nuclei of the myeloid series as well as the megakaryocytic series, which is obvious as hyperlobated megakaryocytes and as hypersegmented neutrophils.
Prognosis of monoclonal B-cell lymphocytosis. You said about low count and high count. Is it a precursor for CLL?
So usually in CLL early stages, unless the count is more than 50,000, we don't treat them, because these patients, the count of less than 50,000 may remain for even 10 to 15 years. So we don't treat them, we don't touch them, we just keep on keeping them under follow-up. So therefore the prognosis of MBL, which is a precursor of CLL, is excellent. The only thing is, every 3 months, 6 months, one may make a smear and TLC to see how much number is increasing. We know now that high count MBL is the one where we really need a follow-up. Low count, where it is less than 500, we need not keep a check on the patient at least for 5 years.
These are the questions. Thank you very much for joining us and giving such a wonderful lecture.
Thank you, Dr. Padma. Thanks to your team. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. So now we are running short of time. So we will break for lunch now and we will meet at 2:30. And our sessions will start at 2:30 and maybe we will end up a little late. And at the end of the third lecture, we will have the valedictory function and the prize.